It's too close. Who was it said they had microphobitis or something yesterday? I'm sort of the same way today. My name is Ellen Brawley, and I am a grateful, recovered Al-Anon. Hi, everybody. When I use that word recovered, everybody thinks I'm an egotist, and they might be right. But I really would like for you to know that I've been in this program almost 22 years, and if I'm not recovered now, then I'm totally hopeless. I would like to say that my recovery is based on a program that you have given me that is God-inspired, and I'm grateful for it. And as long as I observe the principles that there are in this program, one day at a time, I intend to maintain that recovery. It's going to take me a few minutes to smooth out here. I'm not going to run out of gas tonight, but I may run out of oxygen. I have a little difficulty with breathing, and I'm up here in this rarefied atmosphere, and I want to tell you, y'all got some beautiful mountains, but you haven't got enough air. I walked over to the center yesterday, to the museum, and I was bucking a headwind down off of the mountain, and Norwood finally had to carry my pocketbook for me, and when I got over there, he said, "What are we going to do?" I said, "I don't know what you're going to do, but I'm going to sit down and breathe." I finally got my breath, and I was duly impressed with the museum and your wonderful Mr. Wild Buffalo Bill Cody, and with your town and with your mountains. I tell you right now, John Sears and his wife routed me through the Wind River Canyon coming up here. Gee whiz, that's something else. My daughter-in-law in Europe took me to see the Alps, and I thought that was something. But I can hardly wait to tell her that the Alps can't hold a candle to Wind River Canyon in Wyoming. I want to thank you for asking me up here. It's always my privilege and my pleasure to come and share with you. More than that, it's my obligation and my sacred duty to pass on whatever I have received of the message that there is for me in Al-Anon. Now I'd like to give you a few statistics on the Brawleys. First of all, I'd like for you to meet the other half of this team, because he's a point of reference in my story. His name is Norwood. He's my groom of 44 and a half years. Norwood, stand up and say hi to the people. I'm real glad that I stayed with this man. You know, I learned how to stay with him when I got to Al-Anon. I used to threaten him with running off, but I never did, and I never did run him off, and I'm glad that I stayed, because I have observed some people who have broken off with their alcoholics, and then our alcoholic got sober, and he got him a new chick in AA, and they were around and enjoy all that sobriety. And if that was happening in my family, and he had a new chick enjoying his sobriety, I'd be mad as hell. Now, that's just about as honest as I know how to be. As I said, we have been married 44 years and a few months. We have two sons, one who is 42 and one who's 40. We have seven granddaughters. I would like to say that we have some grandsons, but we don't have any grandsons nor any prospects. Maybe we'll have to wait for great-grands on that. We have been coming to the program since, and I say we because we have, since August of 1960. Now, my sobriety date is August of 1960. I'll let Norwood tell you what his is, because that's not really my business, and it was in Al-Anon that I found out that it is not my business. Because when I got here, I thought he was my business. I'd like to run this back by a little bit and tell you about our early married years. I married the boy in the crowd that didn't drink. I was very careful to pick out the boy in the crowd that didn't drink. Now, we ran around this was back during the Depression, and our social life was centered largely in a little neighborhood church. Not because we were spiritual, but because we were broke. And you didn't have any other social life except what went on at church. Now, I went to prayer meeting on Wednesday night because that's the only way Daddy would let me out of the house during the week. Went to Sunday school, went to church, went to young people's, and Norwood was one of the older boys. Norwood was already out of high school when I met him. He had a job, and this was back during the Depression, and that was real important. Furthermore, he was in a family that had a car. That was real impressive. And so we started dating, and I decided, you know, early in the game, that this was the boy in the crowd that I was going to marry. And we women are devious, and we're cunning, and we're baffling, and we're powerful. And when I decided to marry him, then I mapped my strategy, and sure enough, first thing you know, it worked. You know, I ran just as hard as I could tear away from him. And when we were going at a pretty good clip, I stopped dead in my tracks and turned around like this, and I had him. So we married, and almost 3 years later, we had this first little boy, and I'm pretty good at learning things, though. Now, when I had that first one, they really knocked me out, and I did not know anything about his birth. So I promptly got busy, and in about 2 years, I had another one. And I knew all about this birth. I had a different doctor who believed in a different procedure. And that was the end of the line. See, I learned. That was just exactly like my drinking career. I only got drunk once in my life. I did this, and I don't mean I've never been high but once, but I've never been drunk but once. And that was on an experimental basis, and I got quite drunk, and I was quite hungover for about 4 days, and never again. So you see, there's some things that I do learn, and that was one that I learned. It is only by the grace of God that I'm not the alcoholic in the family, for Norwood, as I told you, did not drink when we married. Neither did I. We went to New Orleans on our honeymoon. If you've never drunk in New Orleans, you've never drunk. So we went down there, and we were entertained by some very sophisticated coffee men who were much older than we were, and who taught us and introduced us, not taught us to drink, but they introduced us to drinking. And we had a darn good time down there, and when we came home, we just started partying all the time. We were the first couple in the crowd to get married, and we had a house. And so the crowd made that their headquarters. And they would come, and they would bring their bottle, and we would party. And we had a good time. And then on Saturday night, we would go, and I'm sure I'm dating myself when I say this, we'd go honky-tonking on Saturday night. And we'd go out, we'd play the jukebox, and we would drink, and we would dance, and we'd have a good time. And we really did have fun. Well, I enjoyed it. But about the time that our first son was born, I began to think in serious terms. And I began to think about this dream that I had that almost all girls of my generation had about the vine-covered cottage and the sweet, dear family and father coming home in the evening and everything being just like it ought to be. So I decided that we should quit drinking, and I talked to Norwood about it, and he said, sure, we should. And I did, and by this time, Norwood was sort of in love with the jukebox and the bright lights and and all of the things that went with drinking, and so he drank without me. And so began a pattern in our lives that was to continue for some 19 years. I'm not going into all the gruesome details, but I will tell you that Norwood would drink, and I would raise hell. And then he would be contrite and remorseful, and he would promise me that it was never, ever going to happen again. He would beg my forgiveness, and after he had done several little things that I wanted done, you know, like getting my floors waxed and my windows washed on the outside and the car repaired and all that, I'd forgive him. And then, you know, guess what? He'd do it again. And you know, we'd have to go through this whole procedure all over again. And he would be contrite, and he would be remorseful, and he would beg my forgiveness, and after due time, I would forgive him. And he would promise, and I would believe, and he'd get drunk again, and again and again. And we just repeated this pattern over and over. Our children grew, and during the time that they were growing up, I involved them in the illness of alcoholism in a very unique and particular way. When I get into the steps in a few minutes, I will show you how I did that. But just to bring you up to date, after Norwood had been drinking off and on for 19 years, He finally ended up with his first hospitalization. It was for drinking. It was for some problems he'd gotten into. It was in the Veterans Hospital in Memphis, but it was still at a time when they did not put you in the hospital. The Veterans Administration would not hospitalize you for alcoholism. They put him in the hospital with an acute anxiety neurosis. That was a master understatement. As mad as I was at him at that time, he was more than anxious. he did go in the hospital, and he did get some good treatment, and which consisted of, now mind you, shock treatment. He got electroshock therapy, and after he'd been in there about 3 weeks, they finally let me see him. And because he had had these shock treatments and immediate memory had been erased, he forgot what crisis in the family had precipitated this. And I looked at him, and he didn't have a line in his face, and he had gained weight, and he looked so calm and so peaceful. And I'm out there coping with that world, and I'm still faced with that crisis he left me with. And I said to him, move over. You know, I felt like I deserved some of that, whatever that peace and contentment was he's finding in that hospital. But about that time, the attendant went click behind me, and I realized I was locked in, and I really didn't want him to move over. I wanted back out, and I was glad that I could get back out. He stayed in the hospital for some 6 or 7 weeks, and when he came out, this will show you how little I knew about the illness called alcoholism. I labored under a misapprehension when he came out of the hospital, for I thought that he was, in quotation marks, cured. I did not think that he would ever drink again. I thought we might have some other problems, but I did not think that this would be one of them. Sure enough, he didn't drink for quite some time. We had a real crisis in the family, and he still didn't drink. So I was being reinforced all the time in believing that the cure had taken place. After he had been sober some 6 months, he started drinking again. Where it had taken him 19 years the first time to make the hospital, in 6 weeks, this time he was back in. Now he stayed in the hospital this time 3 months. This is not to tell you his drunkologue. I want to tell you what happened to me. And this is necessary so that I can tell you. He stayed in there 3 months, and I enjoyed his being in there, for I knew where he was. And most of the time when Norbert drank, I never knew where he was. He stayed in there 3 months, and when he came out, I didn't look forward to his homecoming with any great deal of anticipation. I knew that he was not cured. I knew that inevitably he would drink again and we would be faced with the same set of circumstances. So I sat back, and I didn't enjoy. I waited. Very much like a vulture waits for somebody to die, I waited for him to get drunk. And he obliged me. And he got out in 1st of July, and about the middle of August, he got drunk. And I did all the things I'd ever done before. I handled it exactly the same way I had always handled it. And this time it was not any good. You see, when Norwood used to get drunk, I would gather up my little boys, and I would put them in the car, and we would go daddy hunting. And I would find him. Y'all really gonna feel sorry for him before I'm through, because he never did get to finish a good drunk, not very often. I'd find him. And I would demand that he would come home, and he would come home, and I would put him to bed and put my children to bed. I would check the tickets in his truck to see how many stops he'd made that day. I would arrange his next day's route so he could pick up all that he didn't finish that day. I would count the money to be sure he wasn't going to be short when he checked in, or if he was, I could put enough in there to cover it. Everything that needed to be taken care of, I took care of it. And then I sat down and I got my cup of coffee and my cigarette and put my feet up and felt successful. I felt successful. He wasn't in jail. He hadn't killed anybody. He hadn't wrecked the truck. He hadn't spent too much money, and he was home. My kids were home in bed. I was successful. Okay, so this night I'm talking about in August. By this time my children are grown and not prone to be in pocket when I wanted them to be. But this particular night, I knew where they were. I was not upset about them. I went out and found Norwood and brought him home and put him to bed. I sat down in the living room and got my cigarette and got my coffee and put my feet up. And I didn't feel successful at all. I'd handled it the same way I had always handled it, but this time it wasn't worth a damn. This time I was empty and alone and afraid and desolate, and I cannot describe the total desolation there was in my spirit. I have never, ever felt so forsaken. It was terrible. I hope I may never feel that alone again. So what did I do? I got up and went in the bathroom and shut the door. The good book says, you know, that you should go into the closet and close the door and pray, and your Father who hears in secret will reward you openly. Well, I want to tell you, by this time I was pretty mad at my Father. My Heavenly Father, that is. I was really mad at God. And so I went in, and I got down. We had an old cloth-footed bathtub in that little house, and I got down by that, and I said something to this effect. God, if you're there, I doubt that you are. I need some help, and I need it right now. And I don't want you to send me any signs I've got to read or any indications that, you know, I've got to interpret. I want an answer in black and white. Amen. And you know, that wasn't a very good prayer. But I'll tell you what, the God of my understanding today, and incidentally, I'm going to tell you on the front end that my higher power is G-O-D, and it's easier for me to say than higher power and more economical, and that's what I'm going to say. So the God of my understanding today understood that prayer because it was sincere. I talked to God on the level of my feelings. I really was honest about how I felt. Now that was really a gut-level prayer. I recently read that whenever you've got a gut feeling, it's probably gas. But anyway, that night it really wasn't. That night it was real. And it was sincere, and it was honest, and guess what? I never had heard of the Al-Anon program. Now, I'd heard about AA because Norwood had made the mistake when he got out of the hospital of telling me that the doctor recommended AA, and I'd been busily trying to get him to go and to call him and offering to take him and offering to see about it and all that stuff, and he had, you know, bypassed all my suggestions, as usual. And I had never heard of the Al-Anon program, but a couple of days later, in the paper, in black and white, there was a little notice about an AA group in Memphis that was having an anniversary meeting, and in it they quoted an Al-Anon who talked about what the Al-Anon program had done for her and her family. Well, I set out to find out what Al-Anon was. We did not have an Al-Anon office in Memphis at that time. I'm pleased to report at this time that we've grown to such proportion that we do now have an Al-Anon office, or at least an answering service where information is available. But the only thing I could do then was call the AA office, which I did. And they got an Al-Anon to call me. And she told me about a group called the Family Group, which met at 1605 Madison in Memphis. She suggested that I go there on Monday night. And she also said there was a closed AA meeting, and why didn't I invite my husband? And I said, you don't understand. He'd get drunk if he knew I was, you know, doing all this stuff. She said, well, you fooled him before. Don't tell him until you're ready to go, and then ask him. So I did it that way, and sure enough, he agreed to go with me, and we left that Monday night on the 19th of August in 1960 to go to the Family Group for the first time. We went up 32 stairs. I don't know why it was true then, and it's very often true now, that AA's always got to meet up over or over in the back of or someplace like that, and the Al-Anon's even behind that in the coldest in the winter and the hottest in the summer place you've got. But that's the way it was, and we climbed those 32 stairs, and at the top of it, it said, you have now climbed 32 steps. You only have 12 more to go. Norwood went in the coat closet looking for the other 12. I got my directions back to the Al-Anon room, and I would love to tell you that I crawled in there on my hands and knees humbly seeking some help, but that isn't true. Because I operated behind a false facade then, and still do sometimes, I gathered in my gut like this and put my chin up like that, and I sailed in there to let those people know how little I needed them. I let them know how smart I was and how much I'd read. I let them know how competently I had handled my situation all these years. And bless those people's hearts, they bore with me. And they loved me when I was so unlovable. I don't see how they could stand it. I really don't. And every once in a while, we have a new girl come in. And guess what? I just see me all over again. And I know exactly how Hazel and Teresa and all those people felt that night I walked into that Al-Anon room. We had one night. And when I came home from an Al-Anon meeting, I said to Norwood, we had a new girl tonight. I tell you right now, I just didn't think I could stand it. He said, what's the matter? I said, don't ask me. I just can't stand it. And he said, you can't stand what? I said, she's so much like me. I said, she's terrible. A few days later, my good friend Jesse said, Ellen, guess what? I went to a meeting last night and I met a girl named Beth. And you know what? I said, yeah, she's just like me. She said, how did you know that? But you see, I recognize it. And I needed these people so desperately. But because I was not able to receive love, I could not let them help me right then. But I continued to come. And they continued to bear with me. And the first thing you know, one of them, named Jesse, and Jesse always helped me. Jesse was long on love and understanding and short on mercy and tact. And Jesse stopped me in the hall one night, and she said, I want to tell you something for your own good. You talk too much. And you know, Jesse was right, and so I quit talking all meeting, every meeting, and began to listen. And what I began to hear was that you people had a program of recovery called the 12 Steps. Now, as I began to listen to this, I began step by little step, just little tentative things, trying what you were telling me, trying to learn what there was in here that could help me. Now, at this very moment, I want to stop and take time to thank God, as I understand him, and two drunks named Bill and Bob for the program. You see, God didn't choose the most learned philosophers, nor the most brilliant surgeons, nor the most insightful psychoanalysts and psychiatrists to carry the message of hope and recovery. He chose two drunks, people who were not highly regarded by society, as the trustees for the most marvelous message that it's ever been my privilege to hear. And I'm grateful to God for this, and I'm grateful to Bill and Bob that they got it, and I'm grateful to every AA in this room and every AA everywhere for the 12 steps of the program. Let's give them a hand. Step of the program says we admitted that we were powerless over alcohol, that our lives had become unmanageable. When I got here, I don't know about you, but believe you me, I had spent all of my waking hours since the time that I had discovered that my husband had a problem with alcohol, zeroed in on trying to circumvent his drinking. I don't know what you get in the way of your report card, but I get A for effort on mine. Now, I told you about how I used to hunt him down. And that's true. I really did. I hunted him down. He drove a red coffee truck in the city of Memphis, and he used to park the truck and go drink at a local tavern, and I'd find the truck, and then I'd find him, and then I would, you know, see that he got home. Well, I had a route that I would follow. And any time I found a truck near a certain beer joint, then the next time I went daddy hunting, I had to include that particular one. If it wasn't on the regular route, it had to be. So, of course, as the years went on, my route got enlarged. And I would take the children with me under the guise of taking care of them and keeping them off the street and being a good mother. It was really, I found out about my motives. It was so they would see their sorry, drunken state of their father. But I would take them with me, and I'd station one on each side of the back seat, and I would say, now, I'm going to drive up the street and over a block and down the next street and over a block, and I want you all to watch down the alleys because I can't drive and see down the alleys. And if you see the car, the truck, let me know. So here we go. And I'd drive up a block and over a block and down, you know, like a checkerboard. If I didn't see it that way, then I would cross it this way. You know, I really did a thorough job checkerboarding the areas that we had done. And we'd be driving along, and all of a sudden, Woody would say, there it is, Mother, I see it. You know, I'd put on the brakes, and I'd leave a boy with the truck. So in case Norwood came back to the truck, he couldn't get away without one member of the family with him. I'd take the other one with me, and we'd go find Daddy. Then I'd take him home, and I'd pour him in bed, and I'd do all those things I told you about, checking the tickets and all that sort of thing. And one night, I guess it was, this was long before we had all the suburbs taken in. We had not taken them into the city at that time. I drove 154 miles one night. I found him. I brought him home. There were not many times that he could outwit me. Till toward the latter part of the drinking, and you know he used to fake me off because he'd go down one part of town and park the truck and get a cab and go to the other end of town. And I tell you, I really didn't think that was fair at all. I didn't think he was playing fair at all when he did me that way. Now, I have to tell you about the first time I ever went to get him out of jail. He called me on a Sunday morning and told me he was in jail and to bring $51. $51 was a fortune in those days to come down and get him out. Well, I was so chagrined and so embarrassed that he was in jail. And this was a Sunday morning. We had a house guest. I asked her to keep the children, and so I went down to get Daddy out of jail. Now, if you think I went in just my ordinary clothes, you're wrong. I took a bath. I put on my best black gabardine suit. I put on my high-heel shoes and my black seam stockings and my long white gloves and my hat. And I went down to jail to get him out. I looked like I was getting ready to go to lunch at the Peabody because I tell you what, I didn't want them to think that everybody in the Brawley family was a louse. You know, I wanted to walk in there and I wanted to make my impression. And, you know, it got to the point where whenever I found him in jail, that was so good because there'd be 5 hours, I knew where he was, and I could sleep. And I didn't care if my hair was in rollers and I had on my tennis shoes when I went down to get him. Things change. But I spent all that time doing all those things, and after I got in this program and looked at it, not a single time did that keep him from drinking next time. Never. Not one time. I gave lip service to the first step when I first got here. And I said for a month, you know, for about a year and a half, I'd say, yeah, I'm powerless over alcohol. I admit that. Ignored the second half about the unmanageable life. But I would admit that I was powerless. And then after we'd been in here about a year and a half, Norwood was out drunk one night, and I went to my sponsor, Hazel. And I said, Hazel, you know, Norwood and I have been married a long time. Do you suppose that if I were to leave him, if I were to take my bag and pack it and get in the car, and just go and get me a room at the motel and be gone for a week, that he would look at this program, that he might do something about his drinking? Now, Hazel could have given me a lot of advice. She could have good Al-Anon advice, that is, you know, program advice. And she could have told me several things, but she didn't. Hazel loved me, so she just looked at me and she smiled. She said, Ellen, did you ever think about accepting Norwood just like he is? I said, hell no. You mean drunk? She said, just like he is. I said, no. She said, think about it. You know, I went home that night, and I didn't pack any bag, and I didn't go anywhere, and I thought about it. And I took the first step. And without any reservations, way down inside of me, I knew that I was powerless over the alcohol in Norwood. That I was powerless over Norwood. That I was powerless without any power over anybody or anything. That made me face up to the second half of the first step, which is, well, in one of the traditions, I got to move back one here. Our lives had become unmanageable. Now, I knew Norwood was unmanageable. By this time, my children were grown, and they were pretty damn well unmanageable, too. But I never dreamed that I, Ellen Brawley, was unmanageable. I thought that if everybody else in my family shaped up, that there would be no problems at all. Then I got to thinking about all these foolish things I'd done all these years, and I had to know that a life based on total absorption and total obsession with somebody else is an unmanageable life. I had served on boards and committees. I had taught Sunday school and done community work. I never once did those things without my mind being saturated with and obsessed with what his Lord was doing. Every time I was in a meeting, I was thinking how soon I could get out and check up on him. Where was he? What was he doing? You know, I was obsessed with this thing. I was leading a totally husband-centered life. An other than God-centered life is unmanageable. And I was unmanageable. And so I came to the second step, which is came to believe that a power greater than myself, than ourselves, could restore us to sanity. I told you when I got here I was mad at God. Now I knew there was a God. I never doubted that. But I didn't have any sort of a personal relationship with him. I had taught Sunday school, and I had taught Bible in church, and I knew all about God. But I didn't know him. I would like to tell you that I was church-oriented, but I was not spiritually inclined. And therefore, I did not understand that God could do something for me personally, or even that he would do something for me personally. I had called to his attention many times when I was asking something from him how good I'd been. I could enumerate my achievements to him and tell him how good I'd been. And I could also point out to him that he was dealing me a pretty raw hand. You know, that I wasn't getting what I deserved. After I took my inventory, I didn't know how good I had it. But the truth of the matter is, what really turned me off in that step was the word sanity. I knew that I was not insane. I knew that people who functioned every day in society and who reared their children and who ran their house and who were contributing members of society could not be insane. Not I. No one was nuts, but I was not. My children had problems, but I did not. And so it was hard for me to buy the word sanity until I did a little review. And in retrospect, some of the things that occurred were less than sane thinking. I have to tell you about the time that Norwood had dermatitis on his hands, and we had been to several doctors to no avail, and finally he went to one doctor who prescribed for him an arsenical compound that's called Fowler's solution. Now, this is a solution that's supposed to change the blood structure and so forth and so forth, and anyway, it has arsenic in it. And it is supposed to be given in very measured doses, one drop the first day, two the second, three the third, and so forth, on up to the 17th day, you give 17 drops in a glass of water. On the 18th day, you start by reducing it one drop every day, so at the end of 34 days, he's back down to one drop. The first 17 days, he got drunk twice. I am doing the dosing. I got to figure it. On the 18th day, I believe I'm going to increase that to 25 drops, and on the 19th day, I'm going to give him about 30, and by the end of 34 days, he's going to be dead, and I paid up all the insurance policies. Saw to it that everything was... And I also knew that it would be a pretty good alibi because the doctor had prescribed it, and I didn't know. Of course, I wouldn't know that he had given himself a dose when I gave him one. You know, I mean, I had all these things figured out, and you know, we're laughing. But you know what we're talking about? We're talking about premeditated murder. And that's not very sane. Now, the first time I ever told this story from behind the podium, Norwood was in the audience, and his eyes got bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, he knew I'd been teed off a few times, but he never knew I'd felt really murderous about him. And a few days after that talk, he had a very severe headache, and I said, "Honey, want me to get you a couple of aspirin?" He said, "Hell no, don't give me nothing." And you know, even today when I lay out a vitamin, he says, "Are you sure that's a Theragreen M?" He's really kind of careful about taking his own medication. And I can't blame him for that either. I will tell you about one night when we were daddy hunting, and then I've got to move along. But I think that maybe you will know how really nutty I was when I tell this story. Norwood's mother, who was a little 5x5 lady, said to me quite frequently, "Well, you know, he didn't drink before he married." Now, that's not what I heard at all. What I heard was, you caused him to drink. So, as long as she lived in her city, whenever I went daddy hunting, I took her with us. Because I felt like if I was hurting, she should hurt too. I felt like that if she was going to accuse me, she ought to be in on the deal. You know, and now that's crazy thinking, but that's the way it was. So this night we had the two little boys, and we had Mama and myself, and we were daddy hunting, and we'd driven all over Memphis, and we couldn't find the red truck. And as we were coming out Poplar Avenue, I said to her, Mary Lou, when we get to McLean, if we have not seen the truck, take a right and let's go home. You're tired, and I'm tired, and the boys are tired, and we'll give it up. She says, okay. So when we got out to McLean, you know, God, that guy I was talking about, the Ranger Sings, well, anyway, he had that red truck go right across in front of us at McLean, and I said, Memo, there he is, curbing. She said, okay. So she pulled in behind him, and we got him curved right down close to the Idlewild Presbyterian Church over on one of the main arteries in Memphis, Union Avenue, one of the most widely traveled streets we have. And Norwood had a companion with him that night, and that girl got out, and she took off right across Union Avenue, and Miss Brawley jumped out of the car and ran right after, just widely across the street. I got out of the car and got up in the truck with Norwood, relieved that we'd found him, not too disturbed about what was going on, until I saw the cold beer in the car. When I saw the cold beer in the car, I went absolutely berserk. I screamed, I yelled, I cussed, I cried. I had 16 kinds of a fit, and I punctuated it all by throwing those beer bottles out and breaking them all over the street. I had a little boy back here saying, give him hell, mother. I had one over here yelling, catch her, mama. This whole thing going on, and I looked up, and the man at the filling station where we were parked was posing the beer bottles down the drain, and he was laughing. And I looked up, and all the traffic had come to a screeching halt, and they were watching what was going on over here. Norwood has not opened his mouth. He has not said one word. He had his head down like this on the wheel. I thought, my God, they think it's me. Who was it? It was me. Okay. So I said, okay, Norwood, drive home. And he drove home, and Miss Brawley brought the boys, and she went on home, and I went back into the closet to pray, and I asked God to forgive me for my behavior that night. And I kind of bargained with him a little bit. I told him if he would help me not to act like that anymore, that I'd promise not to fuss at this man about drinking. And sure enough, I never did throw that kind of fit again. Now, I got even in lots of little mean, nasty ways when he was sober. But I never did throw that kind of fit again because, you see, that was a reflection on me. Just like marrying him was a reflection on my good taste. You know, I hated for everybody to know I was married to a drunk. I thought, you know, I had better sense than that. But anyway, after I got in this program and I viewed this behavior of mine, I came to understand that I had some insane thinking and some insane behavior and that I needed to be restored. And so, little step by little step, decision by little decision, I began to believe that God could do for me what I could not do for myself, that he could restore me to a sense of usefulness and order. And so I made the decision to turn our wills and our lives over to the care of God as we understood him. For me, the action in that step is one thing, and that's making the decision. Not turning my will and my life over. Making the decision is my action. I'm only speaking for myself now. This is the way it's worked for me. I only had to make that decision one time. And when I made that decision one time, no day in my life has ever been the same since. That does not mean that I have turned my will and my life over to the care of God. It means that every day, one day at a time, that I've been aware of the decision I've made and I've tried. Some days, I've done better at it than I have other days. I do not know about you. Some days my best is better than it is other times. But the thing about it is I have made that decision, and now, when anything's going wrong in my day, I can refer back to the decision I've made, and then I can also have all the rest of these steps for points of reference to know where my trouble is for the day. I don't know about your group, but we can sometimes get hung up on the will of God in our group and discussion meetings. If God would write me a letter every morning on the wall in big black, cold blood red letters, and say, "Dear Ellen, this is what I want you to do today. Love God, I could do it." But he doesn't do it that way, you see. He doesn't give me instructions that clearly. He gave me a free will that I must exercise, and he gave me things like reason and judgment, and he gave me things like a modicum of intelligence and a few things to use, and he gave me the freedom to use them, called a free will. Because this is a big decision for me, I had to be involved in it in three ways, mentally and emotionally and spiritually, and I still do. I have to think about my decisions. I have to be mentally in cooperation with it. I have to feel good about what I'm doing. I have to be emotionally secure, and I have to be spiritually comfortable. So I am involved every day in trying to become spiritually comfortable. And when I am mentally at peace, and when I am emotionally secure, and when I am spiritually comfortable, I'm doing God's will. And I do not have to get bogged down into the minutia of, did God want me to do this little thing this way? I know when I'm doing God's will. I don't know about you, but I know when I am. And I damn well know when I'm not. 4 is made a searching and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. 5 is admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being the exact nature of our wrongs. 6 is we're entirely ready to have God remove all these defects of character. 7 is humbly ask him to remove our shortcomings. The first 3 steps help me get right with the God of my understanding. The next 4 are designed to help me get right with me. I don't know about the rest of you ladies, but at my house I have a junk room. And all year long, things get shoved back in the junk room. The papers, the magazines, the laundry I haven't yet put away, and the laundry that I'm going to iron when I have time, and all the clothes I'm going to give to the Goodwill, and anyway, they all goes in the junk room. And once a year, I straighten it up, and I put the magazines in exactly the order that they should be, and I put the papers in the order that they should be, and I get the trash in the trash bags, and I get all the clothes that are going out to the Goodwill in one spot, and I get all the hangers turned the right way on the rod in the closet, and I get everything straightened up. Now, that's great. But if I don't do anything with it, you know, I've still got all the junk, and that's the way it is with the inventory. For me, I had to search out and find the truth of myself. I talked with the Allens up there this afternoon a little bit about inventory, in which I talked about the AA who helped me the most with this, and that was she really taught me that I'm not looking for what's good and bad about me, but for what's true about me, and that once I found out the truth, that the truth would make me free. And so I set out to find out in my inventory the truth about Ellen. In it, I discovered some things that are true. I don't necessarily like them, but they're true. And one of the things I found out about myself was that I had been motivated by anger all my life. I was born mad, and I got madder as life went on. And I had a deep, burning anger against God and against life and against my husband and against my children and against my father. And it manifested itself in many other defects. I have not been relieved of many of my defects of character, but that one has been removed. I'm not mad anymore. Does not mean that I cannot get upset or vexed or irritated. I can. But I'm not really angry anymore. And that's because I found out what was true about me in my inventory. Admitted to God, to ourselves, and to another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs. I love the AA in Memphis who said the first time he read that, he thought, wow, I'm going to have to tell how many times and with who. But he said, that's not what that means. He said, the nature of your wrongs is if you find out there that you're a thief, you're a thief. See, that's the truth about yourself. And he said for him it wasn't necessary to say, on this day I stole this, and on this day I stole this, and on this day I stole this. The nature of his wrong, that he was a thief at heart. Now he used that hypothetically. I'm not going to particularly go into to all the natures of my wrongs, but I will tell you this, that I have discovered what the natures of my wrongs are, and they're all based on selfishness and self-centeredness. I wanted what I wanted when I wanted it. When I didn't get it, it made me mad. That's just the truth of it. I have since changed what I want. And I try not to want everything my way. I don't know about you, but when I married, I had a preconceived notion of what marriage ought to be like. And I wanted it, and I still don't think there was anything wrong with what I wanted. I still don't see anything wrong with what I wanted. I wanted Norman and me to have a good, sound, solid, productive marriage. I wanted us to be pillars in the community and contributing members of society and members of the church. And I wanted my kids to letter in basketball and football and track and make A's all the time. And, you know, be a credit to the family and be leaders in the honor society. That's all I wanted. And I don't think there was anything wrong with that. But the thing about it was, I never made any allowance for what they wanted. I just wanted it my way, and when it wasn't my way, then I was angry and frustrated. And that led to the nature of many wrongs for me, for I tried to impose my will. I did not have to tell God when I got to this point in the program, because I knew he knew already, but I did get specific and I did do it. And I have to tell you that I have never been to one confessor and taken the fifth step. I would love to stand up here and leave the impression with you that I have. I would like for you all to think that I have worked the program perfectly. I have not. But I have, at this point, taken the fifth step to my satisfaction. If that changes and it becomes necessary for me to take it with one person, I will. But I have never failed to discover a truth about myself and the nature of my wrongs that I have not shared with another human being. Not ever. I have sometimes shared it for my needs and sometimes for theirs, but I have never failed to share it. And when I once make a new discovery, when I am re-inventorying, which I do from time to time, I can't wait to tell it. I just can't wait to tell it, for I can no longer carry it around in me. I have to share it. When I reached the sixth step, and it said I was entirely ready for God to remove the defects of character, I wanted to put the onus on God. I wanted him to remove it. Okay, sure, I'm ready for God to remove it. But one more time, I found out that I have to exercise some degree of effort myself. This is another place where Helen helped me with the program, for she told me that when you become aware of a defect, and you want to be rid of it, and you're willing to be rid of it, then you're ready for it to be removed. Exercise conscious control, asking God to remove it. For as long time as you have to exercise conscious control, you still have it. But one day, it will be removed, and you'll never know when it was gone. You know, that happened to me with anger. That happened to me with anger. I learned how to control my temper and my tongue when I got in here, to a degree. And to a better degree as time went on. And you know, one day I realized that I was full of the joy of living. And when you're full of the joy of living, there's no room for anger. And that one has been removed, and for that I'm grateful. I ask God to remove my shortcomings. I cannot talk about humility, for I do not understand it. I'm told if I think I have it, I don't have it. But I think that if I recognize that whatever I have is God-given, somehow or other, maybe that can be counted for humility for me. Made a list of all persons we had harmed and became willing to make amends to them all. Made direct amends to such people, wherever possible, except when to do so would injure them or others. This, for me, the first time I heard it, I started making a list. And guess what that list was? It was a list for Norwood. I could think of a a dozen things in less than 5 minutes that he needed to make a list and make amends about. And I was thinking about how nice it was going to be when he got to that point in the program. And he made amends. And then when I got to studying the program and understanding, that was, you know, it was me that I had to think about. And then when I reviewed my inventory and my fifth step, I knew who I owed amends to. And the greatest amend I owed was to my alcoholic. You see, I held in contempt a sick person. And that was almost unforgivable. I really held him in contempt. And I transferred this attitude to my children. I used to, not with words, but by innuendo, by insinuation. I'd say, don't count on your daddy for anything. You know, your daddy's a weak sister. You can't count on him. You count on your mother. And you know, when I read some of the psychology books today, I shudder when I think what I could have done to my sons. That it didn't happen that way is my good fortune. It's God's smile of beneficence on me. I owed Norwood amends. I owed my children amends, for I literally robbed them of a good relationship with a darn good father. Norwood was a good daddy. He did all the things that good daddies do. He got drunk sometimes, sure. He was a sick man and he got drunk and he couldn't help it when he did. And these were embarrassing times for his children. But that didn't alter the fact that during all the sober times, he was a good father. He was a good provider. He was a non-abuser. And he did not merit my contempt. And he merited the respect of his children. And I interfered with that. So I involved my children in alcoholism in a way that they didn't deserve, nor did he. So I owed amends, and I owed amends to my own parents. For you see, I never wanted my mother and daddy to know that I had any kind of a problem with a drinking husband. So I would cover up with them. And when they lived away from me and they'd come to visit, I could not wait for them to get out of the house and go home. And so always there was a strained relationship when they were there and they could not understand it. And I did a pretty good job of covering up because, you know, they didn't know for 19 years until he got hospitalized that he had a drinking problem. And that's pretty good because, you see, I would almost threaten him with mayhem and murder if he got drunk when they were here. And so he never did. That was really one of God's, you know, extras for me. But after all this was said and done, I owed some amends to my father and to my mother. Do you know that my daddy, whom I found out in my inventory I hated, lived to be 88 years old, and in the last 3 years of his life, I made my amends to him, and I came to love him in a very special way, and it was wonderful. If it hadn't been for this program, I'd have never been able to do that. And then, bless her heart, my little old 87-year-old mother came to live with me. And I was sharing this with Paul last night, and Norwood knows it. I had a harder time working the Al-Anon program with my sober mother than I ever did with my drunk husband. You see, I had an idea of, like I always did, you know, how it was going to be when mother came to live with me, and I was going to be the perfect daughter, and I was going to take this perfect, magnificent care of my little old fragile mother. Well, I want to tell you, that little fragile lady came down to my house and she took over and she ruled the roost like a tartar. And she treated me like a child, and I want to tell you something, I acted like one. But you know, the program does work. And eventually, when Norwood prided me often enough by saying, you're blowing your Al-Anon, you know, when I would be going around there blowing my Al-Anon, he'd tell me about it. And I'd think it over, and then I'd be able to get my program in focus and make my amends and make my apologies and make it right with Mother. And God afforded me the opportunity, and it was wonderful to have her with me. She really was a delightful little lady, and all my friends loved her, and they never could understand why I became so aggravated with Mother, but then they didn't live with her, so they didn't know. The 10th step, which is continued to take personal inventory, and we were wrong, promptly admitted it, is a point of reference for me. And whenever things are going badly with my day, I can take my 10th step and get it straightened out because I can refer back to whatever it is in the program where I'm missing it. And I'm missing it somewhere or the day would be all right. And there's never anything wrong with my boss. And there's never anything wrong with my husband, and there's never anything wrong with my kids. There's something wrong with me. And if I can find it, you know, the bank, it's okay. And there's something that a girl I'm sponsoring said not long ago, and you know, it was so good that I wish I'd said it, but she said this, and it's meant a lot to me, and that is, just because the day is lousy till 10 o'clock, it doesn't have to be lousy forever. You can start a new day at 10. You know, you can start your next 24 hours right then. And that's good, because I start a lot of new days, you know, in long about 10:30 or 11. After I get to work in the morning, sometimes I have to start it all over again. The 11th step, which is sought through prayer and meditation to improve our conscious contact with God as we understood Him. Praying only for knowledge of His will for us and the power to carry that out. I have tried to work in conjunction with all the other steps. This step, to me, gives me access to all the power I need to live this day. And this is the only day I have. God doesn't guarantee me tomorrow. I've had today, and it's been great. I don't know about you, but when I got here, as I told you, I was church-oriented, and I used to go to a lot of church shindigs, and they called on me to pray quite frequently. And, you know, I could really pray a good public prayer. Because the reason I know it was good was people would come up and tell me it was afterwards. You know, they'd say, Ellen, that was a beautiful prayer, and I knew if they were impressed, God was. And, you know, I found out about all the falsity there was in that relationship. You know, I was praying for effect and for the adulation that came and on an ego trip and all those things. And now, the God I understand is as close as my hands and feet and my breath. And I can talk to Him about anything, anytime, about how I feel. And I don't have to put on any airs. And I don't have to address Him in old English. He does not have to be sirred and deed and thou'd. It just doesn't work that way. And I'll tell you, one of my best prayers is, thank you, Lord, amen. I do this 50 times a day for the most minute little favors that He grants me, and I do it out loud, and I do it in the supermarket or in the office or wherever I am, and it's good. I call these my MINI prayers. Another prayer that I use and use a lot is, not God, you take it. I used to say all the time, you know, when I wanted to turn it over, God, you take it. But that was putting the onus on God again. Now my prayer is, God, help me give it to you. I have to do that a lot because I'm inclined to work on it myself. And so, you know, I'll say, God, you take it. But I'm holding it like this when I'm there. I say, you take it, you know. But what I really have to do is put it out like this and say, God, help me give it to you. And you know, He will, and He does. And He blesses me in so many little ways, so many times a day that I can never thank Him enough. And I don't know about your God, but I'll tell you what my God does. He presents me opportunities. I pray for patience. Oh, does He ever give me the opportunity to exercise it? You know, I pray for tolerance. Oh, God, the people that He sends into my life. You can't believe. You know, but he really knows what I need before I ask Him, and so I accept. And I want to read you something right here that's in the Big Book of Alcoholics Anonymous on page 449 of the third edition. Acceptance is the answer to all my problems today. When I am disturbed, it is because I find some person, place or thing, some fact of my life unacceptable to me. And I can find no serenity until I accept that person, place, or thing as being exactly the way it is supposed to be at this moment. Nothing, absolutely nothing, happens in God's world by mistake. I cannot be happy until I accept life on life's terms. I need to concentrate not so much on what needs to be changed in the world as what needs to be changed in me and my attitudes. God can help me change my attitudes, and He can help me accept life on life's terms. Brings me to the 12th step, which is having had a spiritual awakening as the result of these steps. We tried to carry this message to others and to practice these principles in all our affairs. I have had a spiritual awakening. I'm slow to wake up. But I've had one, and I'm grateful for it. And how selfish I'd be if I didn't want to share it. How selfish if I wanted to keep what good things God has done for me just inside of me. They would wither and die. And so he gave me a vehicle like Al-Anon where I can share what he's given me. And though I like to come to Wyoming and talk to all of you, I'm just as grateful when my sick Al-Anon calls me at 1 in the morning and says, I need your help. You see, I know how sick you can be at 1 in the morning. Do you Al-Anons know how bad it is at 1 in the morning? It's worse at 1 in the morning than it is any other time. That's the time you've walked to the door 1,000 times and lifted back the curtain and put it down and walked floors and said, okay, I'm going to let 5 more cars go by, and if the 5th car is not him, I'm going to bed. And the 5th car goes by, and it's not him, and you say, just five more. And you pace up and down, and you get sicker, and you get wider awake, and you get more apprehensive, and you hear a siren off in the background, and you know it's him, and you know he's killed himself, or you know he's killed somebody, and you wait for the phone to ring, and you're afraid it will, and you're afraid it won't. And at 1 o'clock in the morning, that's worse than it is somehow at 11 o'clock in the day. So when my Al-Anon calls me at 1 in the morning, I'm glad that I can listen. And I'm glad that there is a program I can share with her. And I'm glad I can tell her about fears and about the illness of alcoholism. I want to do that. I want always to do that. The reason I want to do that is because you have loved me and given me a message. God works through people, and he has worked through you this day. And I thank you. God bless you. I love you.